Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Instrument of War, The German Army, 1914-18, by Dennis E. Showalter, narrated by Julian Elfer. Introduction. The Imperial German Army is one of World War I's defining institutions. It is also arguably the most protean. Presented from a prism of perspectives that can be as confusing as enlightening, the army is described in social contexts. Contributing fundamentally to Germany's development as a militarized state and a militarized culture with a resulting century of global-scale catastrophes, the army can be depicted in political contexts as fatally unbalancing an already fragile state system, taking it down the road of military dictatorship in the Great War, and eventually guiding it into the Third Reich. The army can be studied as a social institution, analyzing its internal dynamics from the grassroots to the general staff. The German army can be presented as the other, the opposition to the British, French, and Americans, as mysterious as it was dangerous. Finally, sometimes almost as an afterthought, the German army can be considered as a fighting force, whose plans, institutions, and fashions were so admired before 1914 that for a while American cavalrymen in remote Western outposts turned out for dress parade wearing spiked helmets. And if its combat performance from 1914 to 1918 continues to be trenchantly and appropriately criticized, the German army is also credited with inflicting a disproportionate number of casualties on the Allies, no small benchmark for a conflict whose memory and mourning is heavily understood in a context of lives lost. This work seeks to integrate the spectrum of approaches to tell the story of the German army of 1914 to 1918 as an institution, an instrument of war that, in the developing context of a total war, found itself overextended from before the war's beginning. It displayed less a genius for war than a gift for improvisation, meeting unexpected challenges with limited resources, making the best tactically and operationally of questionable strategies and policies until the machine broke down and the men had nothing more to give. In that sense, this is less a history than a story, an elegy perhaps for an institution that, however dubious might have been its cause, gave the last full measure to attain it. This work is also intended for general listeners. Documentation has been kept to a minimum. For the sake of user-friendliness, whenever possible, I have cited English translations. All the mistakes and misjudgments are my responsibility. Chapter 1. Portents and Preliminaries. In 1898, the Berliner Illustrierte Zeitung, a leading popular magazine, polled its readers on the most significant events and personalities of the last 100 years. The choice of the 19th century's greatest thinker was none other than Helmut von Moltke. In an era of philosophers like Hegel, authors like Tolstoy, and scientists like Darwin, selecting the chief of Prussia's great general staff in hindsight reads at best like a bad joke. Taken as a meme, it reinforces the familiar image of Imperial Germany as a society comprehensively defined by its military culture, as specifically expressed in the army. When Frank House, US President Woodrow Wilson's advisor, wrote from Berlin in April 1914 of "Militarism runs stark mad," he was not reacting as an innocent abroad. Germany's European neighbors might agree on little else, but by the early 20th century, a strong consensus had developed that even by the continent's increasingly prevalent, increasingly comprehensive standards of military planning and military posturing, Germany was in a class by itself. 1. That development was by no means irrational. At seventh and last, Germany had been united by force of arms. A century's dream had been fulfilled not by politicians or philosophers, intellectuals or industrialists, but by soldiers. Moreover, unification's price in lives and money had been cheap. Even during the Franco-Prussian War of 1870-71, total deaths amounted to around 30,000. In contrast with the Crimea or the American Civil War, most had been recorded. Increasing numbers were listed on local public monuments. Unlike their Civil War and World War I counterparts, Germany's veterans developed nothing like a mythology of sacrifice and victimization. Instead, the war deaths had an opposite effect, providing groups and cohorts, whether university classes or soldiers' associations, with foci for a nostalgia that increased as time passed. Nor did unification have a high direct cost. If the South German states had their share of financial problems, Prussia had been able to underwrite victory in 1864 and 1866 by conventional means, the state treasury and the international finance market. Loans and public subscriptions carried the major burden of 1870-71, with the French indemnity coming in to balance the books. War seemed good business financially as well as psychologically. It made little difference that, in fact, the indemnity contributed heavily to the overheated economy and the speculative boom that, in 1873, triggered 2 decades' worth of economic depression throughout Europe. Instead, the promoter's panic was projected as the work of liberals and Jews, or internalized as a punishment for seeking profit without working for it. Internationally, too, the Wars of Unification seemed an unadulterated triumph. A Prussia that for over a century had been a great power only by the courtesy of its neighbours now stood at the apex of Europe, not a hegemon definitely, but a fulcrum with arguably more leverage to come. No longer were the Reich's lesser states clients to be bought, used and discarded, as in the days of Louis XIV and Napoleon. An army that in 1860 had been described as embarrassing the profession of arms now set global standards for doctrine, tactics and even uniforms as spiked helmets appeared on the parade grounds of the American West. Small wonder that Max Weber prized his status as a reserve officer alongside his position as Germany's foremost economist. The Wars of Unification made German geopolitically legitimate. Such once credible alternatives as the Confederation established at the Congress of Vienna, with its joint Austro-Russian hegemony, or the German-dominated Central European Confederation advocated during the 1850s by philosopher-politician Konstantin Franz, had neither support nor viability. In Austria, itself reconfigured in 1867, the end of the old order generated some nostalgia. But the outcome of the Franco-Prussian War was a clear sign that hopes of a Habsburg-dominated Greater Germany, centred north of the Inn River, no longer existed. The Wars of Unification had demonstrated to the lesser German states the advantage, arguably the necessity, of participation in a large-scale military and economic system, particularly since the federal organisation of the Second Reich meant that local mores and local power structures were respected, if not privileged. Factionalism also posed no significant problems, immediate or long-term. Liberal and progressive elements felt themselves so well satisfied with the new imperial system that by most accounts they offered too little resistance to Bismarck's political manipulations during the 1870s. Of the Reich's ethnic minorities, the Poles had nowhere else to go, since no prospects for re-establishing Polish independence existed outside the context of cataclysmic war. The integration of Alsatians into the new state was more successful for a longer period than French nationalism has been willing to concede. Jews had participated in the war enthusiastically in every capacity, from riflemen to surgeons. Their behaviour, while motivated primarily from conviction, reflected as well the hope that finally they would be recognised as fully equal citizens. They embraced the new Reich with an enthusiasm that denied an anti-Semitism, the influence of which up to 1914 was in any case limited enough to seem trivial in retrospect. Catholics made up a one-third religious minority in a state the dominant ethos of which was moving towards Protestantized secularism. But even the bitter Kulturkampf of the 1870s was not enough to alienate them permanently from the empire for which their sons too had fought. An emerging working class had almost to be driven out of the imperial consensus by the anti-socialist legislation of the 1880s. Social democratic leader August Bebel asserted that the Prussian Guard, 90% socialist, would nevertheless shoot him dead if given the order. Bebel may have been exaggerating for effect, but there is no question, in 1914, socialists reported for duty with no significant protest, individual or collective. The common denominator in each of these cases was that no particular element of German society, whether defined in economic, political, or ethnic terms, felt itself sufficiently excluded or sufficiently victimized to reject its chances in the system. Bismarck's demonstrated virtuosity at manipulating interest groups and creating new ones, usually described in negative terms, offered hope as well of improving one's place in the hierarchy. The Wars of Unification provided a common symbolic structure for a German public culture that was increasingly entropic and increasingly locally focused since the 1648 Peace of Westphalia, if not the Protestant Reformation. Munich's Oktoberfest, inaugurated in 1816, was a typical example. Elsewhere in Europe, military plays had flourished during the 19th century. Initially intended to show the power of the post-Napoleonic state, they were evolving as well into celebrations, safe enough for children, respectable enough for families, and with no admission charges, social, religious, or financial. In Imperial Germany, the occasions for these events were overwhelmingly military, less from popular belligerence than because those were the only events the new Reich had in common. Sedan Day on September the 1st, the Empire's defining holiday, combined contemporary celebratory patriotism designed to encourage national identity with a spectrum of local initiatives confirming local traditions. Parades, bands, and speeches by generals became part of carnivals, harvest festivals, and church consecrations in the same pattern of synergy, generally acceptable to a broad spectrum of public opinion. By 1914, even a hardcore social democrat might expect forgiveness from his party comrades for taking his family to the show and stopping for a beer or two. The military system that developed after the Wars of Unification became central as well to gender self-identification, for women arguably no less than for men. The bipolar structure of male fighters and female helpmates had been affirmed and reinforced by the Wars of Unification. They had been short and competently waged, offering limited motives for opposition based on the examples of Desdemona and Lysistrata. They had largely been fought away from homelands, providing limited opportunities for women to be thrust into the roles of victim or heroine. The low levels of loss and sacrifice created limited opportunity for women to establish status as healers and nurturers in the pattern of the American Civil War. As it developed in Germany's mid-century experience, women's function in war was to symbolize its opposite, the peace the Empire proposed to maintain indefinitely and intended to restore promptly when necessary. The Imperial German Army was an army of mobilized civilians. Almost half the men in every active regiment at war strength was reservists. Entire divisions and army corps were also composed of these hostilities-only soldiers. The Germans were far ahead of their contemporaries in accepting the martial virtues of the citizen in uniform. Unlike the French and Russians, who treated reserve formations as second-line troops, suited only for garrison duty or subsidiary missions, the Germans proposed using their reserve units alongside the active ones, giving them the same tasks and assuming the same levels of proficiency. Sustaining a conscript citizen army on the German model of everyone a frontline combatant had two essential prerequisites. The first was that the vast majority of men could be made into soldiers by compulsion and killers by necessity. The second was that, having passed through the crucible of modern war, these men could return to civilian life without permanent, massive psychological damage. A parallel function of the army was to establish paradigms of warfighting that provided links with order and connections to society by channeling and controlling individual and collective energies. Most recruits reported in early autumn, just after the harvest. Fall and winter were devoted to the school of the soldier, instruction in wearing and maintaining uniforms and personal equipment, close order drilling, less with an eye to parade ground display than to developing skill in group movements, physical training, marksmanship, and not least standards of order, cleanliness and hygiene vital for health in barracks that were at best close and Spartan quarters. Time and patience played a much larger role in German training than familiar accounts and mythologies credit. Most conscripts remained in the companies where they were trained. The sullen and the intractable could not simply be passed along like low cards. Effectiveness as an instructor was not only a serious responsibility, but a fundamental criterion of retention and promotion among both NCOs and officers. They were given wide latitude in securing results, a peacetime exercise of the individual initiative so important in German operational doctrine. Latitude, however, did not mean license. Too many black eyes and split lips on parade, too many entries in a company punishment book, and the responsible authority could usually count on an unpleasant session with his own superior, centering negatively on his career prospects if the situation continued. In early May, the recruits were inspected. Most of them were assigned to full-time duty in their original companies. The rest of the spring and summer was devoted to battalion and regimental training, then manoeuvres. Most were working day affairs at corps and division level. The showpiece was the imperial manoeuvres pitting corps against corps, observed, and under William II, increasingly muddled, by the Kaiser himself. In autumn, another fresh class of recruits, Hummel, castrated sheep or dummies for their short haircuts and clueless bewilderment, crowded the barracks. The newly minted reservists invested in souvenirs, checked travel schedules, and looked forward to intimidating the younger generations with peacetime war stories. A system designed for instrumental purposes developed a wider social and cultural context as well. The German army emerged as the nation's primary male rite of passage. Masculinity is fundamentally a social characteristic. A male is a man when he is accepted as such by other men. The criteria for that acceptance usually involve some kind of initiation process specific to the group, from dueling fraternities for university students to Wanderjahre, journeyman years, for aspiring craftsmen. These rituals, however, were likely to carry little external weight. The drastic changes in German society since the mid-18th century had, in any case, marginalised many of them. In the Second Reich, military service developed as a replacement, an alternative common denominator. Going through the conscription process, even without actually being assigned to active duty, certified male adulthood. It validated claims to permanent employment, to a seat at the men's table in the Gasthaus, to think even of starting a family. German youth was part of a society that laid significant stress on stereotyped and distinct sex roles. It was described by a contemporary sociologist as male-defined, patriarchal, rigid, militaristic, but one that also enabled the questioning of that pattern just enough to generate male societies in which the feminine element in men could be legitimately and safely expressed in same-sex but not overtly sexual situations. Old soldiers bullied the new ones, but usually in the sense of showing them their place in this new world, as opposed to the comprehensive, efflorescent brutality that characterized the Soviet Union's armed forces in the regime's final years. From the army's perspective, hazing that became more than an uncomfortable game was bad for discipline. From the old-timers' point of view, hazing could be expensive in other ways. A man on the downside of his active service, someone who knew the ropes and judiciously shared them, seldom had to pay for his schnapps and cigars. Few conscripts had not experienced something similar as boys and adolescents. In Germany, as indeed throughout Europe, for young men to be caned, slapped and beaten by parents, teachers, clergymen, employers, and neighbours was an experience so general that even to the victims it appeared natural and necessary in the maturing process. The rigours of army initiation were further mitigated by the sure knowledge that one's own turn on top would come with the passing of time. Few thought of complaining, fewer still acted on the thought. Only a Muttersöhnchen, mama's boy or sissy, who occasionally found himself in the barracks instead of paying for the privilege of serving 1 year as a volunteer and living off post, complained. The collective and temporary experience of military service worked against conscripts forming particular friendships, but that was not essentially different from civil life. On the farm, in the factory or the shop, even the schoolroom, participants came and went with increasing frequency in an increasingly mobile society. But in the army, more than in the workplace, comradeship was generated by need. The government provided little in the way of institutionalized services. That meant a middle-class son who received generous packages from home was expected to share out. A man apprenticed as a tailor or cobbler in civilian life, a clerk who wrote legible letters from home for the less articulate, a farmhand or a domestic servant able to shine leather and clean uniforms was welcome in barracks, even as a recruit. The army's place in that meme is best expressed in nicknames. The captain was the father of the company. The Feldwebel, the first sergeant, was the company mother. The accepted reply by a recruit asked what he wanted to become in the army was an orphan, but the underlying reality the images implied was more than their sarcastic dismissal in a universally familiar joke. Historian Uta Frevert, anything but an admirer of the nation in barracks, speaks of the peacetime regiment as a family. And if its potential for nurturing individual development was limited, the same is true for all families. 2 or 3 years in the German active army was no easy rite of passage. Behaviour by the NCOs, a boxed ear, a kicked backside, a tirade of imaginative comments on a soldier's ancestry and character, could be complemented systematically by burdensome extra duty involving kitchens, latrines, and, even in the infantry, stables. The conscript's new world invited dissociation from emotional and behavioural traits associated with the subaltern domesticity that defined and limited young men's civilian experience. Smoking, drinking, idleness, all the things good mothers warned against, were barracks norms. Sexual talk, rigorously suppressed by parents, teachers, and pastors, was theme number one for previously repressed young adults. As for action, at least in Berlin, it was not unusual for the girl to pay for a date, particularly if the man served in an elegantly uniformed regiment. Army life nurtured a particular masculine culture socially as well as sexually. Relationships with fellow soldiers of the regiment, the company, and the barracks formed and defined an individual's identity. Draftees usually spent their entire service in the same unit. A reputation once established was correspondingly difficult to change or shed, and could make the difference between nostalgia and nightmare. Self-control, endurance, grace under pressure largely defined that reputation. Ein ganzer Kerl, or a real man, was expected to stand his man against anything the army threw at him. To do his duty but take no shit, as one social democratic official advised a group of conscripted party members. As one piece of army doggerel expressed it, anyone who had not spent 3 days in the guardhouse on bread and water for some breach of regulations or for angering a sergeant could hardly call himself a soldier. At the same time, good officers and NCOs understood when to look away, to laugh or swear at the infinite ability of young men to pitch tents on Fool's Hill. Active service, moreover, could be a positive experience. German standards of comfort, particularly among countrymen and the working classes, were sufficiently Spartan that army food, army beds, and army routines did not represent a steep decline in quality of life. Military service, moreover, could salve the perceived wounds of modernization. Traditional conservatism and modern liberalism alike postulated a direct connection between effort and result. Individuals and groups achieved success through their own efforts. In the course of the 19th century, however, industrialization and agribusiness steadily diminished the relationship between that meme and economic reality. The alienation of wage labor in mines and factories or on landed estates was paralleled in towns and cities by an emerging and subaltern class of white-collar employees trapped behind counters and desks, and in the country by a peasantry that might be legally emancipated, but whose economic position was steeply and visibly declining. Hard work now pitted men against machines that wore them out and broke them, or against complex, impersonal systems impossible to comprehend, much less master. That matrix nurtured Marxist and Völkisch ideologies, both to the Second Reich's detriment. The army, however, was different. It was fundamentally designed to enable success. Like a university, a corporation, a church, or a hospital, it existed to do something. No system, however, can function if a significant portion of its members cannot meet the system's standards. The German army, moreover, was a secondary institution. The demands of rifle marksmanship and physical training, the drill ground and the route march, might be high but could be met, and not only by a chosen or privileged few. If many German men spoke with favour of their military service, it was because they achieved there the kind of visible, recognised triumphs denied them the rest of their lives. A cigar from the captain, a chance to win one of Kaiser Wilhelm's prize medals, promotion to Gefreiter, private first class, towards the end of one's time as an incentive to re-enlist, might not seem much, but the reward was in the context. The army also had a way of challenging conventional civilian hierarchies. A labourer good at drill, an artisan with an impeccable uniform, was more likely to be well regarded by the officers and NCOs than a well-off merchant's son with two left feet and perpetually dull boots. And if a blundering gymnasium student earned the whole squad or platoon extra drill or extra duty, the offender was likely to receive a midnight visit from the Holy Ghost, a beating administered by his barrack mates as an unofficial motivational exercise. Contemporaries before World War I and scholars afterward have described Imperial Germany as ultimately ruled more by the sword than the scepter. The dominant consensus has been that the army that was built on the victories of the Wars of Unification expanded its influence in state and society to an extent making the soldiers fundamentally, if not entirely, responsible for a diseased Sonderweg, special path that led to two world wars, the rise of Nazism, and the destruction of a European order that, while imperfect, was, in its openness, its tolerance, and its opportunities, preferable to the German-generated alternative. In fact, whatever may have been the dreams of some of its generals, the army of the Second Reich remained a subaltern institution. To a degree, this was structurally determined. The increasingly contentious relations between Otto von Bismarck and Helmut von Moltke during the Wars of Unification are too often misrepresented in the context of friction in a parliamentary system between a prime minister and the armed forces along the lines of Winston Churchill and his generals in World War II. In this view, Moltke's claims for autonomy in the conduct of military operations, his challenges to Bismarck's proposals and decisions, represented a move to undercut civilian political authority. Reality was a good deal more complex and, to a great degree, the product of a compromise. A decade-long constitutional conflict over the army's status was resolved in the aftermath of Prussia's victory over Austria in 1866. Bismarck accepted Parliament's rights as a legislative body. Parliament, in turn, acknowledged the King's autonomous relationship with the cabinet ministers and his independent position as Commander-in-Chief of the Army. It was a Solomonic decision, reflecting a widespread belief that neither party could resolve the issue in its favour at an acceptable political and social cost. A cabinet model had characterised Prussia's government since the 18th century, de jure and de facto. Both Bismarck and Moltke saw themselves functioning in its context. Thus, in terms of its own perspective, Bismarck was closer to a cabinet secretary on the US model than to a prime minister directly answerable to the Prussian parliament. The system was also flexible enough that Moltke was, by 1870, de facto a full member, despite his increasingly nominal structural subordination as chief of staff to War Minister Albrecht von Roon. Relationships were collegial, with the hierarchy of influence largely determined by circumstances and personalities. By 1870, Bismarck and Moltke were the alphas, but the positions of both men ultimately depended on the decisions of the executive. Moltke did not regard Bismarck in the same way a French general of the Third Republic regarded the premier. A more appropriate parallel would be the relationship between the Departments of State and Defense in the US cabinet during the Cold War and later. And King William of Prussia was hands-on, sufficiently conscious of his power and position to use them sparingly. He was a good deal shrewder than history often acknowledges, anything but a cat's paw of overmighty or overambitious subordinates. Prussia's bequest to the new Reich was also Bismarck's legacy. Bismarck, after 1871, had worked consistently and successfully to nurture and exacerbate institutional, as opposed to situational, conflicts within the military. In particular, he separated the War Ministry, the General Staff, and the military cabinet in charge of personnel matters, reporting directly to the Kaiser and functioning as a back channel. Bismarck's intention was to set the three against each other as a means of limiting the soldiers' direct involvement in politics. The result was a command structure sufficiently divided internally that the army's influence on German policy, foreign and domestic, remained not only limited, but sufficiently diffuse in many cases to be best described as random. William II, Germany's emperor after 1888, head of state and primary public symbol, was obsessed with the trappings of war-making, almost at the expense of his other responsibilities combined. One of his first acts on assuming the throne was to issue a proclamation emphasizing his special relationship with the army. Within a matter of months, however, the Kaiser had established a reputation as a poser and flaneur, interfering randomly in everything from the conduct of annual manoeuvres to the appointment of senior officers. Alfred von Waldersee, Moltke's successor as chief of staff, described the Kaiser as lacking knowledge and experience, with no impulse to improve because he thinks he knows everything very well and better than anyone else. Considered in the army's internal context, William's behaviour was more irritating than consequential. His incapacity in military matters was so widely acknowledged that most of the time he could be sidestepped, neutralized, even ignored in matters more serious than the details of uniform or a regiment's honorific title. And when that did not succeed, the emperor made a handy scapegoat. His decades-long preoccupation with a globe-girdling navy to underwrite a vaguely defined Weltpolitik further distracted William's attention and strained his capacity for focused decision-making. And yet the vacuum at Germany's power apex was not filled by the army, neither by default nor assertion. In 1875, and again between 1887 and 1888, it was Bismarck who held the ring. Leo von Caprivi, Bismarck's successor as Chancellor, then Caprivi's successors Hohenlohe, Bülow, Bethmann-Hollweg, kept fundamental, if at times uneasy, control of the Second Empire's fundamental decisions, war or peace. The notorious War Council of December 1912 produced bluster but not decisions. While the respective degrees of responsibility are hotly debated, it is increasingly clear that in the summer of 1914, Bethmann and William made the fateful decisions that brought Germany and arguably Europe into the Great War. For all his decades of bloviating, at crunch time, William never advocated preventive war. Indeed, at the ultimate sticking point, he compelled the soldiers to delay the occupation of Luxembourg while awaiting a final word from Britain. What then of the generals? In early July 1914, probably around the 6th, the military began to check the readiness of the armed forces. The crosstalk, as recorded in diaries and memoirs, shows significant discussion as to whether the developing international situation was favourable or unfavourable to Germany. There is no evidence, however, of groupthink patterns involving either support for a preventive war or open-ended support for Austria-Hungary. The latter situation indeed inspired as much reserve as enthusiasm. Habsburg military effectiveness was not highly regarded in higher German military circles. Prussian War Minister Erich von Falkenhayn, for example, was present at the meeting of July the 5th when William first discussed his pledge of support to Austria, but more as a spear carrier than an advisor. His declaration that the army was ready was unsurprising in context. It was the sort of pumping up by now second nature to generals dealing with William. Even more to the point, for Falkenhayn to say anything else was tantamount to offering his resignation. That day he wrote Moltke, currently on leave, that he expected nothing to come from this latest contretemps. Moltke responded by continuing his cure. His deputy, Georg von Waldersee, was on compassionate leave due to a death in the family. On July the 8th, Bethmann-Hollweg advised him to take some additional time to recover health shaken by recent surgery. Waldersee would not return to Berlin until July the 23rd. Wilhelm Gröner, head of the vital railway section of the General Staff, was visiting Bad Kissingen for his health. Not until July the 25th did Moltke return to Berlin. Indeed, not until the Austro-Hungarian ultimatum to Serbia and the breaking off of Austro-Serbian diplomatic relations and the proliferating reports of Russian military preparations did Germany's generals begin to take seriously the prospect that the long-projected Great European War might indeed be upon them. The ultimate trigger of a war-focused consensus was the increasing number of reports of Russian military preparations coming from external sources like Sweden, as well as German intelligence, that began coming in on July the 28th. 2. Might all this have been an elaborate deception plan to lure Europe into a false security? It is difficult to imagine conspirators having that kind of insouciant confidence in the face of a long-anticipated Armageddon. Instead, when reduced to basics, the general's consistent contribution to high German politics in the July crisis was to assure the emperor and his ministers that the army was prepared to be about its fundamental task, and that the army could deliver. But never let your mouth write a check your hands can't cash is as fundamental a principle in starting a world war as a street brawl. How did the army's accounts and credits stand as the guns of August began rolling into place? Diplomats, by their nature, prefer to avoid wars. Politicians are ambivalent. Soldiers take wars as a given and focus on how to win them. Soldiers in 1914 were also the ones with detailed knowledge of the increasing complexities of mobilization. This gave them leverage in any small group discussions. Since civilian authority, Bismarck increasingly concluded, accepted the army as competent by definition, far more than did their counterparts in the other great powers, these reassurances were welcome, arguably necessary, to the diplomats and politicians. The question of the army's military effectiveness was exacerbated by the army's success as an instrument of socialization. That success was underwritten by year after year of peace, the continual growth of the population combined with lower death and disability rates in a safer, healthier society steadily increased the raw numbers of potential soldiers. At the same time, Germany's political parties might agree on very little, but as a rule they saw, albeit for varying reasons, no reason to expand the army budget sufficiently to make universal service come close to a reality. The conscription system correspondingly developed an increasingly broad spectrum of loopholes. Its definitive legal statement, conscription remaining in force until 1914, was the Military Service Law of 1888. That provided for 3 years of active service, reduced to two in 1893 and five in the reserve. Those not inducted were assigned to a supplementary, Ersatz reserve, for a 12-year term. This reserve included all men temporarily unfit or excused for specific reasons. Grounds for exemption metastasized. Men who were the sole support of families or elderly parents, men able to make a case that service would threaten a family, business or profession, self-employed craftsmen, small shopkeepers, all could be excused active service. Unwilling warriors in the universities were known to benefit from wink and nudge diagnoses of things like flat feet from fraternity brothers graduated as doctors of medicine. By 1914, almost half the empire's eligible conscripts met one or another of those categories. In other words, an ever smaller percentage of the males eligible for conscription actually performed active service. The army had no room for them. Military authorities seldom challenged a system that enabled exempting the kind of men experience suggested would be more trouble than it was worth to make into effective soldiers. And that included as well urban recruits whose family or employment profiles suggested sympathy with social democracy. Poles and Alsatians with nationalist profiles and similar potential troublemakers. The result was that by 1914, around half of the men theoretically eligible for military service at most spent a token amount of time with a supplementary reserve, learning nothing they might reasonably be expected to retain. And that figure generated some awkward questions. To a significant degree, the active army and its reserves were self-selected, drawn from those who, for some reason, did not seek to pull threads to escape. Would the socializing and conditioning aspects of military service be as effective on men from the other half of the spectrum? No less to the point, the Prussian-German system had developed after 1871 and, as far as the army had been concerned, in an environment of profound peace. Whatever threats might cause frissons in newspaper headlines, government offices and military headquarters seldom excited the barracks. But might actual war bring the social contract to a breaking point? Could a citizen army prepare to fight a war when half its soldiers had performed only nominal service? Would men whose training and conditioning was based on drill and manoeuvres, in plain words, on playing soldiers, be able to rise to the demands of high-tech industrial war? 3. The army's position in Imperial Germany was ambiguous. On one hand, it assumed, sought, and was assigned the role of a primary social institution, demanding ultimate loyalty from and control over its personnel while on active duty, but the army was also a secondary institution. It existed to do something. In armies, corporations or universities, abstract claims, whether of justice, compassion or equity, tend to be balanced against a need for results. The ultimate issue for a secondary institution is not doing the right thing, but doing the thing right. Could the German army do the thing right? Did the professionals understand the next war well enough to win it? From the Peace of Frankfurt in 1871 to the outbreak of World War I in 1914, it was generally accepted both at home and abroad as embodying a particular gift for making war. Current scholarship, however, increasingly describes that army as consciously plunging Germany into war, knowing it would not and could not be the short conflict that was the only kind of war the Second Reich stood a chance of winning and surviving. Suicide from fear of death is one historian's mordant verdict on a military system that preferred risking annihilation to existing in a modern, pluralistic industrial society. The theorists and the field soldiers responsible for developing war plans and attitudes understood war not as an end in itself, nor as an opportunity for displaying either the soldiers' virtu or the patriotic zeal of the German people. War was a rationally calculated extension of state policy. Moltke the Elder described the best practical method of waging modern war as prophylactic, keeping conflicts short by a combination of quick victory and prompt negotiation. As the 19th century progressed, however, that concept was influenced by an increasingly apocalyptic understanding of war. The research of uniformed scholars comprehensively stressed confusion, Panic, horror, and blind chance at all levels. The infantryman's life in particular was understood as solitary, nasty, brutish, and above all short. As early as 1895, a general staff officer prepared a memorandum evaluating the prospects of a German offensive against France. Given current technologies and force structures, he concluded the best to be expected was a limited advance followed by tactical stalemate. Army and people must understand that the most offensive of spirits would achieve no more than a step-by-step advance, demanding as the price a nightmare's worth of blood. How could the turn-of-the-century German army best address that problem? One approach, closely associated with the Conservative Party and conservative movements, was relatively broad-gauged. It developed along the lines of a dual militarism, with the army striking an unstable, arguably contradictory, balance between maturing into a relatively limited force committed to upholding the domestic status quo and evolving towards an ideologized mass instrument able to overshadow the navy in implementing a German drive for world power. A second paradigm, more operationally focused, addressed the tensions between quality and quantity. In this model, the army was torn between externally focused militarists advocating total national mobilization at whatever domestic cost, and technocrats supporting higher levels of material preparation at the expense of mere numbers. At planning levels, these concepts were not mutually exclusive. A force that could engage domestic enemies immediately and wholeheartedly, and an army that could cross frontiers decisively from a standing start, were hardly mutually exclusive. Alfred von Waldersee, appointed Moltke's deputy in 1882, and his successor in 1888, believed Germany needed every possible force multiplier without being particularly specific. Waldersee's successor, Alfred von Schlieffen, defined his responsibility for maximizing Germany's military capacity as concentrating on operational planning and enhancing operational readiness. Germany's geography, its domestic structure, and its level of military preparation all called for prompt operations. Instead of playing to its enemy's strengths by a series of frontal encounter battles, Schlieffen argued, the German army must seek to force the next war's pace to the point where its opponents would be able to do nothing except react. General staff exercises in the 1890s increasingly tested the possibilities of a lesser force defeating a larger one by concentrating against an enemy's flank, then driving against his lines of retreat. Among Germany's probable enemies, France was most vulnerable to this kind of shock and speed. Geographic and political considerations impelled its concentration forward along the frontier, where its army could be fixed and destroyed by superior German fighting power. Russia, in turn, could receive the same treatment at more leisure if it did not conclude peace on German terms. Armies, not peoples, were the targets of German theory and German doctrine. A battle of annihilation was not the prequel to a war of annihilation. That position addresses a major recent specialist controversy in the German historical community. It begins with the fact that social Darwinist ideas were prevalent, arguably dominant, in military circles. It continues by describing a relationship between imperial German colonialism and Nazi German racial policies. It concludes by asserting a direct connection between the uniquely brutal, at times genocidal, behavior of the German military in China and Africa and their successors' comprehensive contributions to the Third Reich's crimes. The syllogism is intellectually satisfying and politically correct. The middle, however, is missing. At no time before 1914 did the German army pay serious, systematic attention to the Reich's colonial experience. The army in particular was fixated on Europe. Its Africans were few in number and marginal in status. Nothing developed remotely resembling the colonial cities in France and Italy or the Asiatic one in the Russian army. Preparations for and conduct of imperial operations were haphazard and inefficient. Colonial operations were discussed in domestic political contexts, the stuff of newspaper articles, election campaign literature, and parliamentary rhetoric. They were never incorporated into either the principles or the practices of planning for real war in continental Europe. The motives for and the links between the German army's behavior and the world wars are better sought elsewhere. The army's institutional response to Germany's perceived grand strategic situation was to focus the Second Reich's war-making capacities ever more closely on ending the next war as rapidly as possible, even if it took just a bit longer than public and political opinion might wish. From the field army's perspective, whether in general staff circles or at a rifle company level, managed war appeared to be the Reich's best means to that end. Limiting participation in the greater worlds of policy and diplomacy, the soldiers concentrated their energies downwards. Operational effectiveness became the multiplier expected to override geography and politics. Between 1890 and 1914, the German army increasingly concentrated on three focal points: intelligence, mobility, and firepower. All were material-based. All appeared susceptible to the bureaucratic and technocratic virtues of management and control. All appealed to an officer corps whose mentality was increasingly influenced by a belief in technological progress as complementing rather than challenging traditional martial virtues. Taken together, they offered the possibility of reconciling innovations with institutions at, respectively, strategic, operational, and tactical levels. Thus they fit, perhaps too well, the army's search for vectors strong enough to guide the way into a new military century. In a quick war scenario like that developing in Germany, forewarned was forearmed. Preparing to fight outnumbered and on two fronts required the broadest possible spectrum of accurate information on all possible enemies. That meant the kind of bureaucratized processes increasingly natural to the German army. Signal interceptions, attaché's reports, and above all, evaluation of the increasing amounts of printed information about armed forces placed in the public domain by parliamentary debates, journalists, and specialized publications offered relative freedom from the catch-as-catch-can world of spies and counter-spies. It was like constructing a castle from toothpicks. Most of the material, by its nature, dealt with details of armament, organization, and doctrine. As a consequence, it facilitated the development of intelligence in Germany as an operational tool, as opposed to facilitating the political aspects of strategic planning. Unpleasant surprises were still possible. They could now, however, be quickly evaluated and promptly normalized. As 1914 approached, the fog and friction that had so often hobbled the offensives of 1866 and 1870 seemed increasingly susceptible to dissipation through diligence. In the East, Walter Nikolai had established a formidable reputation for his success, developing a combination of electronic intelligence built around the radio station in Königsberg and a solid network of field agents, mostly disaffected Poles and Jews, supplemented by Russian officers with problems of fast women, slow horses, and low cards. It even included sabotage teams in position to destroy key rail bridges. In 1913, Nikolai was promoted to chief of Abteilung 3A, the military secret service and counterintelligence bureau, and assumed responsibility for another well-established network of agents and observers across the French and Belgian borders. Here, however, his successes proved limited. The Germans seemed to have acquired detailed knowledge of French war plans into the 20th century. Increasingly, however, in reaction to the intelligence fiasco that triggered the Dreyfus affair, the French plugged old leaks and prevented new ones. The Germans found out little about Plan 17, which was only adopted in April 1914, or the changes in post-mobilization deployments. That information gap only encouraged a growing downward focus in German planning. Collecting estimates of French intentions was less important than enhancing the Reich's operational abilities. An even clearer, arguably far more significant example of that development involved Austria-Hungary. Even before the conclusion of the Dual Alliance in 1879, German military attachés were deeply embedded in the Habsburg information structure. Their comprehensive reports included perceptive and accurate evaluations of the shortcomings of Vienna's military system. The Entente's pre-war experience suggests frank communication and focused financial assistance from Berlin could have significantly improved Habsburg military effectiveness before 1914. Instead, the General Staff and the Foreign Office alike systematically ignored information that at least might have made Austria's catastrophe less of a surprise. By 1914, German military intelligence was so narrowly focused that not until July the 23rd were the intelligence officers of the Eastern Corps districts officially informed that Berlin was interested in keeping abreast of military events in the Tsar's empire. Not until the 25th did Nikolai explain to his immediate subordinates that a war was likely and the department was expected to keep an eye on France and Russia. Nikolai's office began receiving a significant number of reasonably verifiable reports of Russian military preparations the next day, presumably forwarded from various desk drawers and pigeonholes. Whether he is interpreted as an alarmist or a warhawk, he saw that the data moved immediately into decision-making circles. Moltke remained skeptical until shown an official Russian placard proclaiming mobilization. Across the other frontier, observers and agents described increasing and public Belgian defensive measures. Initially, the country's proposed mobilization might have been in principle a defense in all directions, directed against France as well as Germany. But Belgian preparations focused heavily on reinforcing the fortress of Liège, the crucial immediate barrier to any projected offensive involving large-scale violation of German neutrality. Intelligence thus played a significant role in justifying Germany's mobilization and Germany's declaration of war. It did so, however, in an operational context rather than a strategic one, and that confirmed the Reich's emphasis on its rail network. Railroads are usually interpreted in strategic contexts. In Germany by 1914, they were an operational instrument. Their ability to move men, equipment, and supplies into a theatre of war had been clearly demonstrated during the Franco-Prussian War. Over the next four decades, improvements in track design and roadbed configuration enabled ever greater concentrations of heavy, high-speed traffic on a given set of lines. Improved communications facilitated control and timing of traffic. The growing bureaucratization of Germany's railway system provided an organization increasingly capable of collaborating effectively with the military on long-range planning. So important, indeed, did railroads become in the everyday routine of the general staff that the latter's ethos began taking on some of the creed of railroad procedure: continued, reliable, predictable service independent of any specific individual. The nature of modern railway systems fostered an offensive approach to war in two ways. Most obvious and most often cited was the encouragement of war by timetable. The schedules of train movements, prepared in peacetime with such increasingly elaborate care, could not be altered lightly. Quite apart from the actual difficulties involved in such a process, the years of time and effort spent developing the administrative structure of mobilization generated their own momentum and their own mindset. The most familiar illustration of this came on August 1, 1914, when William II, his spirits temporarily buoyed by hopes of French neutrality, announced to his chief of staff that now all Germany needed to do was concentrate its entire strength against Russia. Moltke the Younger, insisting that the result would be mass chaos, responded with a nervous collapse. After the war, a senior officer on the General Stairs railway section, outraged by the implied slur against his bureau, demonstrated in a Teutonically learned monograph that such a shift had indeed been possible, in theory. But when facing an ultimate professional challenge, officers who had spent careers shaving kilometres and hours from train schedules were psychologically unlikely to imagine, much less seriously consider, scrapping their life's work in response to a mere change in external circumstances. Firepower, last on the list, was also most familiar. Since the days of Frederick the Great, the Prussian-German army had ample opportunity to learn that lead was deadlier than steel. That lesson was incorporated in the 25 active army corps that were the army's heart. A German corps was big and power-laden. Two divisions, each of two infantry brigades with two regiments apiece, and an artillery brigade of 72 pieces. But the dirty work was still done by the foot soldier. A German infantry regiment included just over 3,000 of them, in 3-4 company battalions. They carried a rifle a cut below the best available. The Gewehr 98 was a Mauser design. Sturdy and reliable, it was bulkier and clumsier than the British Lee Enfield and the US M1903 Springfield, neither as rapid firing as the British weapon nor as accurate as the American. These points were, however, less significant in an army much less interested in individual aimed shots than in producing concentrated, controlled bursts at the right time. Field tests, even under artificial peacetime conditions, demonstrated time after time that an exaggerated emphasis on individual marksmanship, the approach fostered by imperial awards to the army's best shots, was less important than volume of fire, with the first round placed somewhere near the target and the rest more or less in the same place. An even clearer indication of the German army's appreciation of the potential of massed small-caliber fire was the new organization most regiments were taking into the field, a company of 6 water-cooled Maxim automatic machine guns. The machine gun companies were unique in two ways. They represented concentrated firepower, in contrast to the diluted version provided by the two guns per battalion standard in other armies. And unlike most such new creations, which are built on the discards of other units, the machine gun companies usually had not only first-class cadres, but no fewer than four officers for around 100 men, only one officer fewer than a rifle company 2.5 times as large. This complementing of organic firepower with organizational flexibility reflected the German army's focus on the machine gun, less for its defensive potential, generally understood, but for its perceived uses in preparing and supporting the offensive. The company's six guns were the essence of infantry, able to work in two-gun platoons in direct support of battalions and companies, no less able to concentrate fire on an objective until the very moment an assault was pushed home, even after the artillery had to cease for fear of hitting its own men. Since the Franco-Prussian War, German artillerymen had emphasized method over speed. The field entrenchments that had been challenging obstacles in 1870 were becoming increasingly formidable, as demonstrated in the Russo-Turkish War of 1878-79. Black powder, low-power shells could be expected to have a correspondingly limited effect, particularly in the broken, built-up country of eastern France, expected to be the primary theatre of operations. German gunners were expected to cope by reconnoitring firing positions carefully, ranging their targets systematically, and making few changes in position once the fighting started. The replacement of gunpowder by cordite in the 1880s did not change the principles of methodical destruction of enemy fieldworks and methodical preparation of friendly infantry attacks, nor did the improved recoil mechanisms introduced during the 1890s affect the German artillery's emphasis on system. The introduction of the Model 1896 field gun, with cordite rounds and an effective range of 7,800 metres, seemed a triumph of a quarter century of technical and doctrinal development, until the French unveiled their paradigm-shifting 75 a year later. A decade's worth of tinkering produced between 1905 and 1907 the Model 96 NA, Neue Art. Its shorter range and slower rate of fire than its French rival reflected the continued German conviction that artillery was best used in masses to deliver well-aimed, well-directed fire over extended periods of time from concealed positions. Training put increasing emphasis on observation, on shooting from maps, and on maintaining communications among observers, guns, and infantry. Each division had its own artillery brigade, two regiments, each with six gun batteries. And in 1899, the gunners received a major reinforcement. The 10.5-centimetre field howitzer 98 was the end product of years of debate. Critics said its range was too short and its technology too primitive to be effective against modern field entrenchments. But its shell was twice as heavy and had twice the explosive force of the C-96. German gunners learned to love it. An updated version had an improved recoil mechanism, improved ammunition, and a shield to protect its crews. In 1912, the initial allotment of one battalion per corps was increased to one per division, the highest of any army in Europe except the British. At the same time, the foot artillery was acquiring a new lease of life. Originally restricted to siege and garrison roles, it had paid increasing attention to providing support for the field army as well, but was handicapped by the weight and clumsiness of its guns, and the army's reluctance to provide draft horses. With the new century, however, not only horses were made available. The firm of Alfred Krupp and the army's gun designers combined to introduce a 15-centimetre heavy howitzer that was the counterpart of the French 75 in terms of bringing increased firepower to the battlefield. It could throw a 90-pound explosive shell 7,500 metres. In its improved and shielded versions, the heavy field howitzer 13, dubbed Krump and Jack Johnson by the British, would drive the backbone of Germany's artillery in World War I and become the model for a broad spectrum of imitations. By 1914, each active army corps had a battalion of them, four four-gun batteries, a mailed fist for the corps commander, whose crews prided themselves as able to take their three-ton pieces anywhere the light artillery could go and demolish anything that blocked the path of the infantry. Like the infantry, in short, the German artillery went to war with an integrated system of weapons, doctrines, and attitudes based on a defensible evaluation of past experiences and expected conditions. The firepower evolution even affected the cavalry. The most professionally and socially conservative of the army's branches, it began gradually modifying its historic role of deciding battle by mass charges as the 19th century waned. After 1900 and the introduction of machine guns, the mounted army's principal role shifted to reconnaissance and screening. Almost half its regiments were assigned to the infantry for close work. The 11 cavalry divisions the army took to war were expected to ride ahead of the main formations, some providing information and security and, of no less significance, others launching raids and pursuits as opportunity offered. This was the cavalry's contribution to keeping the front fluid and the offensive moving. The mission harked back to the days of Seydlitz and Murat, but the means were fundamentally different. While cavalry was still expected to do most of its work on horseback, the amount of time given to serious marksmanship training increased. The final version of the traditional carbine, the Car 98, competed reasonably with the US Springfield and was good enough to remain, slightly modified, as the standard German infantry rifle throughout World War II. Each cavalry division had 4 radio stations for communication and a machine gun detachment of 6 Maxims. The army also had a number of Jäger battalions, elite light infantry whose 4 rifle companies were supplemented by a cyclist company and a machine gun company with 6 Maxims. The battalion also included a truck column, the 10 vehicles of which were enough to keep the unit supplied, and to run a shuttle service enabling the foot soldiers more or less to keep pace with the troopers under field conditions. This embryonic combined arms battle group was hardly a breakthrough instrument, but a cavalry division or corps could usually count on having up to 3 of them attached to do the heavy lifting. The German army's emphasis on the tactical offensive was in no sense an unconsidered decision. The difficulties accompanying attack under modern conditions were recognized and accepted in Germany long before the first rounds were fired from the guns of August. But no army, however confident in its general's abilities, could afford to base its doctrines on the assumption that enemies would be obliging enough to dash themselves to pieces on one's own rifles, artillery, and machine guns. Sometimes, somehow, it would be necessary to go forward and get through. In war, as in so many other human endeavors, the necessary tends to become the possible. German doctrine did not assert advancing was easy, only that it was still feasible under the right conditions. Troop movements and fire support must be exactly coordinated. Attacks must be precisely timed. Reserves must be at hand immediately, when and where required, to bolster a weakening position and even more to exploit victory. In the absence of reliable short-range communications, even lieutenants must strike a fingertip balance between dispersion and control, keeping their men from bunching up on a skirmish line, yet keeping them in hand for the final decisive rush. Not romanticism, but hard, practical considerations led the Second Reich's army to concentrate as heavily as it did on human factors. In this respect, paradoxically, the Industrial Revolution offered increasing grounds for optimism. Images of the 19th century industrial worker frequently assert factory routines dulled the mind. The reverse was far more likely to be the case. Participation in a modern industrial plant demanded high degrees of alertness and cooperation. The miner, the mill hand, the iron worker could rarely detach his mind from what his hands did or from what his workmates were doing. What civilian employers could do, the German army saw itself able to do even better. In particular, the revised drill regulations of 1906, which set the pre-war infantry's doctrines and subtexts, recommended in paragraph after paragraph the need to develop inner assertiveness, the compulsion to reach an objective no matter the risks and costs, with orders or in their absence. And the long-distrusted, often despised factory workers might well set the example, social democrats or not. The German army's morale was more than the creation of blaring bands and cheering civilians. It was more than the belligerence of ignorance. German men who took the field in August 1914 were part of a society with a long tradition of compulsory military service. They were overwhelmingly either serving soldiers or men who had worn uniforms sometime earlier in their lives, however briefly. American military writer S.L.A. Marshall once declared that when a soldier is known to those around him, he has reason to fear losing the one thing he is likely to value more than life, his reputation as a man among men. The structure of the 1914 German army was designed to foster this mutual knowledge and to take advantage of it. 4. But how was this instrument of war to be best employed? The focus of that question, the Schlieffen Plan, has been challenged and dismissed as a military construction riddled with internal contradictions, a product of post-World War I myth-making, and as something that never existed at all.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.